islands lie off the southwest coast of Ireland, at the extremity of the peninsula of Corcoraine, County Kerry. These islands are the most westerly in Europe. The water around them is deep, the bottom uneven, with sudden transitions from deep to comparatively shallow water, and the tidal streams are strong. This is the village as it was in its heyday. It nurtured three important writers. They wrote three remarkable books. Tomás, born on the island around the year 1856, wrote his autobiography on Tulánach, the islandman, the most important of the island's books. Tomás died in 1937. Muirisheó Súlavein, born in 1904. His book, Fehiblian a Farce, 20 Years of Growing, achieved worldwide circulation in various translations. Muirisheó Súlavein died in 1950. Peig was born in 1873 on the mainland. Peig married into the island. Her autobiography, Peig, covers life on the mainland and the island. Peig died in 1958. Below the village lies Cullonalan, the island landing place, a small breakwater and slip. Adequate for the purposes of today's visit by the exile island men, their relatives and friends from the mainland at Dunchin. The Naevoga, the canoes are weighed only with their crews. When the island was inhabited, the Naevoga would enter the collar with their gunwales leveled with the water under the weight of fish, lobster pots, or perhaps animals. The loading and unloading process was a major task, and after a long day at sea, a tiresome one. The canoes would then be carried up the slip and rested on their perches, or starchi. With a crew of at least three for each Naevoga, this scene gives an idea of what the sea-going population of the island was before the Second World War, sometime in the early 30s. The island subsisted on the sea harvest, two ingredients necessary for survival, fish and fishermen. Neither was to last.
Two of the islandmen make their way along Bohrvunnanvile. They look towards Anthravon, where Eile Nichols, friend of PHPS, drowned tragically. All movement of the island is from the sea up against the hill. It's something you begin to notice after a while. Sean Fatstam and Sean Vaiklean saw the final days of the island. Men gather from all directions at the top of the village after a visit to their homesteads. Finally, they come down from the hill over Lakawirish, crossing Antocher, or the new road, and down through the remains of Bunanvile, past the house of Flint, whose son married Peg Sayers, and Sean O'Shea, who drowned off Inishnabro. Here they stop, looking over on Hulaoig, Kosan Yara, and Rhin and Chislán, towards the island strand on Travon, and out beyond Beginish to an road. Garod Chashtokahan, son of the island musician Sean Chasht, is the youngest of the group and the last child to leave the island. John Velo Dín Chlé, a relative of Odín Chlé, the island poet. Sean Vaik Lén Ogahín, fisherman. His grandfather was the island king, Rí an Oileán. Sean Fatstam O'Carna, fisherman. His father was one of those involved in the attempt to save Eile Nichols and Cart Crihin from drowning. Seanín Vikilo Sulevan, fisherman and musician. His father was a boatwright. All of these men have been touched by immigration. Many of their brothers and sisters and their immediate relatives emigrated to Great Britain and the United States. This visit to the island gives them an opportunity to recall their life on the island. Here are the islands from Mám Clasach on the mainland at Dún Chuain. The final view for many an islander on the long road to America. John Millington Singh, who visited the Blaskets in 1905, described the Great Blasket as an island which seemed to rise like a mountain straight out of the sea. The village on the east side of the island, facing the mainland, winds its way up towards the brow of the hill, tucked away now in a camouflage of desertion. The most discernible aspects of it are the remains of the congested district board's two-storied houses built in 1909. The only cultivated part of the island stretches away from the village to the right, as far as Thraigarry, facing in Balach Cael, and right down to Anthravon. Each of the fields has its own name, Garry Vafer, Garry an Rí, Untrasnón, Gortfada, Slánbán, Fochrach an Líhig, Gort an Ard, Cánagurt. The bottom of the village, that nearest an Chala, was known as Bunanvile, and the upper part of the village as Baravile. Robin Flower, the English scholar, described the village. The old houses huddled together on the broken hill slope over the cliffs, thrown down without system wherever a convenient site offered itself. The steep little tracks run hither and thither between them. Tomás Crihin gives an earlier picture. The chlacha agus the vorsteil cre e vich na teisin dienta. Agus gan mor chlach dar elanacha. Mar vich daulo agus lav gach einyanta. The house at the top of the village was that of Tomás Belvoir Oan Odinchle. The house of Marini Skanloan, on Doyle, where many of the younger people of the island gathered in the evenings for recreation, music, storytelling, and song. Close by in Doyle was one of the village wells, Tabaran Funkain. Here was a gathering place for the islanders, particularly for the women. Tomás Crohin used this as a vantage point from time to time. Bunima machan tabar. Murrevna na stadon ni lago maidene. Vi bachedes fehaun agas ni chalishke keme adon yed. Ach girun lae ik salmerachle na chele. Coming up from Bunanweiler, Sean Foyley O'Cahain, fisherman, one of 10 children of Morris Vurish O'Cahain. Of the three who went to America, one still lives. Another lives in Wales, one other in Dublin, and the remainder in West Kerry. This dispersal is typical of the island families. Somewhat below the house of Foyley is that of Sean Vaik Lane O'Gaheen. Sean Vaik Lane is a grandson of Padre O'Cahain, known as Rionalan, or King. The O'Gaheen came from Inishikalan in tragic circumstances. I guess This house was eventually Ireland holiday home for Robin Flower and his family. It was to the King's House, however, that Robin Flower first came. These are the remains of the King's House. Here also it was that John Millington Synge stayed on his visit to the Blaskets in September 1905. Synge was keenly observant about aspects of Ireland life. He also brought his camera with him and has left a small series of valuable photographs, probably the first taken on the island. This is a picture of an Rí taken above the village. A group of islanders outside the King's House. An Rí is to the right of the picture, and to his right is his daughter, whom Synge described as his little hostess. Synge's notebook, written in the Blaskets in 1905, described his little hostess as small, beautifully formed woman, with brown hair and eyes that are usually found with this type in Ireland, and delicate feet and ankles that are not common in these parts, where the women's work is so hard. Synge scholars have identified the little hostess as the prototype for Peggy and Mike in the Playboy. Synge wrote a poem on the king's daughter. You've plucked a curlew, drawn a hen, washed the shirts of seven men. You've stuffed my pillow, stretched the sheet, and filled the pan to wash your feet. I told them I was sleepy and ready to go to bed. So the little hostess lighted the candle, carried it into the room beyond the kitchen, and stuck it up at the end of one of the beds with a few drops of grease. Then she took off her apron and fastened it up on the window as a blind, laid another apron on the wet earthen floor for me to stand on, and left me to myself. Some of the islanders, and particularly the king's family, did not like the references which Synge made to the living conditions which he observed. Synge himself was not by any means complaining, rather reporting with a sympathetic eye. The house of Mihal Corny or Cahan, next to the house of Tamokarna, and then the island schoolhouse. Tomás Criomhthain and his companion the king were at school there from about 1866. It was very difficult to get teachers to come to the island, and more difficult to get them to stay. Maureen, Liam Martin, and Tomás O'Carna, Eileen Igohin, and Maureen Igohin were the only pupils on the school roll in the early winter of 1941. The school was closed that Christmas under the direction of the Department of Education. The beginning of the end.
I was
Schooling on the island was a preparation for immigration. It had to be so. The economics of a small island community required that most would leave it for America. Fishing in small boats and a meager produce from the island were cause and effect. The role of the school teachers was to prepare the island pupils for the long road. One of the last teachers on the island described the task. Just below Bohrvonanweiler lies a row of three houses. Those of Sean Owen O'Dean Clay, the White House, Sean Vihilo Kerner, Akawan, and the house of Pardeen Tomás O'Kerner, the son of an Chalach Vildarish. Behind them is the house of Tomás Donald Crihin, the islandman. This he built about 1888, 10 years after his marriage. This is a rare piece of archival film shot sometime in the 1940s. The well-known Kruger Kavanagh accompanied the cameraman into the island. Here, Kruger is seen dancing a Kerry set with an island girl outside the Crihin house. The wind vane, to provide power for the island's radio telephone located in the island post office. The radio telephone link was installed in 1941, the very year the island school was closed. Family homes were already falling into disuse. The Osulavoin house, a stable. The island sheep, which provided the basic meat diet. An old woman drives a red cow to pasture. These years, the war years, were to see the final running down of the island community. Turf had to be won. The island was cold in Atlantic winters. A job for women and the younger men and boys. The turf was harvested here at an Anfart Garav, at the southern side of the island. and as far as Sliavarandaig Laun and to Undoon at the western side. Some of the place names here indicate extensive cultivation in former times during the period from 1830 to 1860, when the population was augmented by those fleeing from famine and from land problems. Gari and Cherke, on Fark Veen, Bultan, Park and Yatta. All of the island writers describe trips made by them and others to south and west of the island, almost in a way which indicated an escape from the claustrophobia of the village atmosphere. Here it was that Tomás Scrihin met the poet Ordín Chlay, that Murish O'Sullivan met George Thompson. Here also the islanders courted. Seanan Vickers' father was a boatwright and carpenter, skills essential in an isolated island. Boats, the Naivoga, had to be repaired, recovered. The sea claimed its share. Men drowned in pursuit of their livelihood. Tom Daly na Hinnisha recalls the death of Sean O'Shea. He was fishing with Tom Daly's father, Paddy Varus, off Inishnabro. They were the sons of two sisters.
This year here, clown about to differ about Hinnisha Bow. I guess she had the first she was in the Andrew over. Sean Shannon in the year. I guess we got to hear about the fatigue. Sean, oh, there are killing the stool ready to bunt your scorn through 10 minutes of program for him. If I had to wait. Hoy mae, bydd ni'n ysgol, agos fi Sean, sy'n ei fod i'w darw yma, i ddechrau gwych o bac. Dwi'n mae i'w rasio yn bws. Yn bws. Agos na ffaith eich gael i ddiam yn bws. Agos ni'n hwg se siwng gyda fi'n ar i'r ffad gael. Siw hwn gael. Agos ni'n unig, siw hwn. Mae'n fwg sy'n biach hwg, agos Sean tref le. Agos, o'r bwyt eich fwrs o'r sgydydd, oedd eich gan yn llawn. Dwi'n mae i'r cael eich ni o'r fachau. Hwn gwaith ag yna i wyl, ac i gen i rywyr hynny. Agos, cael eich dachan o'r fawg. Fi eisiau gwneud eich ddwchni eich tynnu nes y brow, ac fi eisiau ffaith eich. Rhaen ti'n chwad eich dachar de, bersi eich ymwag yn eich rawn o gyda gynt. Chrsi o'n rawn llang eich gynt, sbwg eich dach i. Agos fi eisiau gweld yn ymwbwys eich bian o'r de. Ac fi eisiau wan ddysgu. Agos, ha cwch i ar yn gwyl sleng marsio eich. Gwch sy'n nis ydyn sy'n bwlybog. Ac yn ymwneud eisiau trawa, eisiau cawn ysgym o chasni. Ac eisiau gael, i mi gwneud o'r iasdi. Ac eisiau gael ni'n diach maddi. Ac eisiau chwysio ddys bys yn sy'n tiwa badeli. I mi ffaith i bys yn bygint, chwysio nis. Chwysio sŵr sy, ac eisiau mi eisiau gysyn sy'n tynnu. Ac eisiau ffarwyl dawn, dyn nhw'n ffart 3,000 sy'r fwy, gan 3,000. Rwy'n ffarwyl dawn hir yn tynnu. Ac yn ychydig yn dynnu, gath y tîm pobl i dynnu. Hwn eisiau nhw gwrth, sef mali, gwrth dwrt sef gwrth tîn iawn. Gwrth fi sbedi, byg nhw wrth yn ystig, sy'n dda o'r ddyn nhw. Ac yn dwrt sef gwrth byw mahaid, yna fehaid, gwrth sef nhw'n dynnu di mali. Ac yn dwrt sarai yn ystig, leis, cwm ffi gadach sef ni gennym, mach ac yn gwrth 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 O, ni a ganis yn eich yna dwrt sef. Ach, ganis dwrt sef, gwrth eisiau gath y tîm pobl i dynnu. Gwrth pedi hwn Tarbio a thocwyd i besio o'n oedd yn tŵ. Tarbio. Oedd yna wwg sy'r yn mwy, achos o'n i'n mael nion i gan ywch o'n ei. Dwi'n siarad pam o'n mwy gan o'n wach i. Ac yna wet ys gael, ond eich oes ys di'n dig yn y madr i hwyr, madr le siawn, ac ys madr le sienig. Ac ys os ni'n madr i siawn i gob. A bwyd, nid hag y dîs na chan tron hwn, fi chyfa dra hyn, badr le siawn, ac ys yna siawn chygam. Os na siar gob. Fi eisiau gan ewa, fi eisiau pan mwy gan ewa. Fi yw egin ysg gweld da, diwnt yn rhaen i eli. Ac fi'n bael o gilheg yw hwyn ychydig eid. Ffarn a gath eich ffad y bae. Ach, ni wyd eich rhywb o'n eich arbo. Dyrst y gwyl yn arig, ffai y gwynt eich eich gwaith eich ewa. E, gwaith eich
ewa.
Er eich gwaith eich gwaith eich.
The islanders lived a frugal enough life. Their basic diet derived from the sea. Potatoes augmented with a small selection of vegetables grown on the island fields. Harvesting their small crop was not a prolonged operation. Getting in additional food supplies from the mainland was another task. That and moving in and out of the island of their stock in the Naivoga.
Fi, siro rhawn, fi chwana fwy na'n achta gwna i. Fi'n di chi fart. O, fi hana jabwys. Chaf fi'n fawr sys iddi slip o'r gyd slip. Ac ys, mwr o'n fi ar y fe lag, cadlau marsio, ac ys, i lag yn sŵn. Ac ys, fi siango. Ac ys, hana jabwys i chrystach na'i fwy. Hana jabwys ffad, ro rhawn. Ach, Fi'ch na fwg wedyn, sy'n allan na fwg na bo, ac o'ch wedi tychain ni, mae chedd na fwg na bo. Ne mae'r gym ti, i marw o. Sy'n ddim yn fi anna warw yn sy'n.
There was nothing distinctive about the island men's dress except its poverty. The island women, on the other hand, wore a very distinctive dress upon marriage. The shawl, the apron crossover, and the long skirt identify the status of the married woman. Much of the burden of the island work was carried by the women. They cooked, spun yarn, sewed, mended clothes, reared children, sanded the floors, managed the kitchen, and watched anxiously for their menfolk to return from the sea. The birth rate was high. Being remote without nurses, priests, or doctors, the women looked to their neighbors skilled in such matters. But life had its lighter moments. Music and dancing were important elements in the island culture. As with other skills, the islanders made many of their own instruments. Peg Sayer's house lies well up the hill and to the back of the village, one of those built by the congested district board in 1909. Her house was a favorite rendezvous for the young of the island. Dancing and music gave the young people an opportunity of meeting in convivial surroundings. Sheila and Patrick Flower, son and daughter of Robin Flower, spent a number of holidays with their father on the island.
Well, the dancing was very often held in Peg's house. She was very hospitable in that way. And it was, of course, dark. One went to this... I wonder why it was dark. It was summer, wasn't it? But it was. It always seemed to be dark.
Feeling of dark, yes.
And the room would be lit by a turf fire and an oil lamp and the little tiny red lamp before the holy picture, which was a feature of every kitchen. And the room would be very full of people. There were people sitting all the way up the stairs and people sitting on the table and the boys on one side of the room and the girls on the other. And quite a lot of the boys would be crouching on their haunches. They didn't have much furniture. They had a dresser and a table and perhaps two or three chairs. And so when there was a crowd, there was not room for everybody to sit down. And it was quite a feeling of an assembly because there was this formality of the boys on one side and the girls on the other. And before the music started, the boy would come up and ask the girl of his choice to dance, and she must answer yes or no. And so then the music would start, and it was very, very lively dancing, reels and sets. And then when the music stopped, everybody, boys and girls, retreated to their side of the room. And that was it. How late it went on, I just don't know. But then there came the journey home, when it was totally dark. I mean, it was very dark. There was no artificial light. No street lighting, of course. But the girls used to escort us home, because the boys were diving to get a kiss from us. And we thought this was terrific at the age of 14 or 15. And we used to prolong this journey home a bit, probably. And finally we arrived safely home, and this howling mob of boys would be outside the window, waving through the window and blowing kisses to us. And so a dance was a very exciting thing in those days.
The village strand and Travan was a football and hurling pitch. Tomás Crihin played hurling here with his two uncles, Diarmuid and Tomás, one Christmas day. Víoch Bert Bathtahe, Tharon Daeve na Gha Meir, Maradirfa. Víoch Acre Farracha Sona Hoogwint, Noga Míoch Amíoch Ar an Draig, Rainta Chile Chéle. Camáin agus Lirode Víoch Aon an Wershin. Is Ar an Draig Vána Víoch an Báiracha, Gan Stocca na Brog. Amach Gaman Eil, Éan Wara Héchan Lirode Dan Arige. Fagá lá díag na nalag ní bhíoh sé go mas éon ir san leán a bhómh agat chun chnic le tinnis drama agus tinnis cnáb. Cos ghubh ar Bert, fear eile ar lechais go ceann mí. The days of 30 young men fielding a hurling team on the Travan were coming to a close. This is a photograph of the island village taken sometime in the 1930s. The fold in the center is due to the fact that it was carried in the wallet of a Blasket Islander right up to the time of his death. Marison Funchaen left the island in 1925 and spent the rest of his life in Springfield, Massachusetts. He died in
1981.
Son of an island musician, Sean Chasht, and Breed Varus Vurish, spent his early childhood in this house at the top of Boreen and Tivoin. The island population had been reduced to some 30 people when he was growing up.
Rogach Mission saw Nadig Data Shacht. Agathimon Gorn is a tick shot, at fact Shamblina, digging that she's a mark of Dunkin. Visail Kuhn, Waginachistoch and so. Many of Morandi now. Ti bredio gwni hedder ffad fi o'n ar y fysa. Achos fi'n chodd ysmoca, crina. Fi dacha, ma'n eistio. Agos yn dynnu bog ysdoch o fiedn y lawn. Ach mae hen ach bwncr. Fi'ch seo'r bragan yn so. Rwy'r hytawrig. Fi'ch stron sieri tacht y stach. O i frachach, so gwn chyn. Agos dan bris yn so. Chodd ysmoca. Yr yna blina. Agos chodd ysdoch o tîm bwyr ym sy'n anolog. Agos chodd ysdoch o tîm bwyr ym sy'n And so he's one of the ways I'm going to. I guess the events are taking nach mahed, mawahed, mahed kriena, mawahed kriena. Here we are. And then I'm going to come here. The first time I saw that tigi hulavan, I guess last year that tig, the doll, Tomás, I guess Paddy, I guess Shana Feddy, Gartran on it. Sigirin, I've been here to father, and so could he shiny vicar. I guess far more cure of a shiny. And a him, I guess, a cure. As the Vinagoni, Mike, my comrade, digam, Jahar, the shining. Far nachre, more on, or even on trying to go my again, real. So I have mentioned Tom Gulley and a cane. So I'll try and want you to Sigiri. Your shining is shining to Vedinus, your Mike is Mr. Gersterflesh, I guess, and the Shannon Winter who has come on. A ringy, your Shannon Crew, I guess, so. Sminicus Keenum, Gorry, more a gee, very shady. I guess, and cool on born a gold nose aboard and some sort, ringy. Scar we him up. Nagle can go, we had doig, Marshino, or Veganish. You have no doors, you don't interfax after new, if you had Father Oscar Tenecher. Maar wie een eindje roog roei. Dat is... Ik moet aan koog deschen, zo. Ik zei aan de gorgen. Goed als moeders te gaan te zegieren. Zeg, van mijn doort, stoog. Zeg, kroeg. Kieuw in uweg nog gewaar. Ach... Wie zei aan de gorgen aan de kroeg, aan de kroeg zegieren. En nadien. Hebben een knikken, een knokken zo'n zoos. Dat is aan de jakker. Rees zoos, ik ga niet knik. Het is 14 maanden eerst en zijn dorst wordt hier gewoond en gesmashed. Ik heb een bunt gewoond en ik heb een Ik een jacket door de weer resource. Ik heb een schaal aan ont, rehetorig. Ik heb een zachtnarig. Ik heb een kastel in ogen van me. Ik heb een trecht aan een happig. Ik heb een kritische zoden, ik heb een resource kunnen gelijk. 14 maanden eerst is gaan en naar hen neer graag gekomen. Ik heb een keer nog hier vader in ogen en 40 resource kunnen gelijk. Ik stond ook een zeer hebben aan de groei. Ach, wie geloofde in ik ook niet. Niet wie ik heb het enige.
Once a year, the parish priest and his curate made a station visit to the island, particularly for the older people. This is a film shot some years before the final evacuation of the island. The occasion was the annual station mass held on the island, probably the last one. The schoolhouse, a surviving role of island chapel for the station mass. Mass is read by Father Tom. Father Mihalo Kisan hears confessions outside. A simple breakfast. The island post office. Tomás Crehan's house. Agalovna Shenorach. The decline in the population and the average age of the inhabitants of the island in this film is self-evident. The island musician, Sean Chasht, his wife Breed, and their son Garoed. Recollections and tranquility. A farewell to the visiting priest and his party. A day well spent. Time was when Barnyunach would have been black with people. The sea wasn't always just a sea journey from the island to Dunhuin. The islanders plowed the sea like others their land, putting to sea each day during the mackerel season and the lobster season was as normal for them as walking the land for others.
This is where their work began. The boats move out from Anchala and around by Ungub to the southern side of the island. There was a time when the islanders worked the island waters from seine boats crewed by 8 men with 2 sails. This was in the early part of the 19th century. Tomás Criomhthain described the coming of the first Naoise Óg to the island. 2 drunken islanders brought one home from Dingle to the dismay of their families. During his lifetime, and to the end, the islanders fished from the Naoise Óg. The population suited such a venture. A crew of 2 or 3, and lobster fishing was particularly effective with a small craft. Each part of the island coast had its own name. Ungob, Korsaskanen, Korsdabrehaen, Korsdov, Korskanachnik, Lachachanachnik, Korsnamalan, Korsachoelvain, Potchochil, Korsdote, Korsvlaklia, Beelchopil, and at the end of the island, Kaundov. Clearing Kaundov, a view of the islanders' world in Ishnabro, and to the far horizon, Tiracht with its lighthouse, and to the north, Inishtwishkert. Inishtabro, Kernstone Island, is the least accessible of the Blasket Islands. The 1851 census recalls an occupancy of a family of 4 in what was apparently a beehive hut. Lambs were fattened here. The island caves provided the islanders with seals. Past Inishnabro and Kaundov, through Unbelakkael, and towards the landing place at Inishikalain, past Unvarkricht, into Unrinchil. The meaning of the name of Inishikalain is now lost to us, but the name occurs in Anglo-Norman deeds as far back as the 13th century. There are early Christian remains on the island. An oratory in plan like that of Galerus. An early carved cross. And the remains of a monastic enclosure. These remains, like the others in the Blaskets, are probably connected with St. Brendan. The island figures extensively in the written literature of the Blaskets. Tomás Criomhthain and Mauricio Sulivan describe visits which they paid there at various intervals. This island was inhabited in more recent times, from the very beginning of the 19th century. The baptism of a Catherine Goheen is recorded for the year 1808. Here at Lugna Villa is Tigna Hinnisha, where Muintir Gala lived and eked out their living as herdsmen and at fishing. They were renowned for their skills as craftsmen. Tom Daly's grandfather, Morris, was born on the Inish. There's a considerable amount of fairy lore connected with the island. It was on the island also that somebody heard the tune of the fairy's lament, Port na Buki, the essential and perhaps unique part of the island's musical heritage.
School in Surrey, I guess, never there, so I can go ahead and clack back to the
Tiaracht, the most westerly of the Blaskets, contains an Irish Lights lighthouse built in 1870. Tiaracht is some 3 miles from Calndov on Oileán. Inish Tuishkirt is the most northerly of the Blasket Islands. There are baptisms recorded for this island as far back as 1815. The last was recorded in 1835. The island was inhabited up to the 1850s. Used, like the other islands, by the islanders for bullying, transhumance, and the fattening of stock, including sheep and pigs. It is a sea journey of some 5 miles from the collar on the Great Blasket to the landing place at Loch na Muicke. Sean Fat's Tam used to bring sheep on and off the island, up and down these rocks and cliff. On the 14th of June, 1838, John Wintle, the Cork antiquarian, and Father Casey, parish priest of Ballyferriter, visited Inish Tuishkirt. Wintle's account is now preserved in the Royal Irish Academy. We found great difficulty in ascending the rocks and the steep, slippery turf above them. The soil is half peat covered with a coarse grass, occasional heath, and abundance of sea pink. A few sheep on a temporary visit from the mainland browsed over this uncompromising pasture. The poor human inhabitants consists of one family of the name of Cain, a husband and wife, and 2 or 3 children. They inhabit in a shallow hollow adjoining an ancient enclosure containing a rude cemetery. Their dwelling is one of the old circular cells, the roof of which is formed by overlaying flags, and the family have formed a small hole in the roof to let out the smoke. Cain, head of his family on this island, was absent on the mainland. His wife wished to entertain the priest on this his first visit during his 19 years incumbency. And she ordered her son to run and kill a couple of rabbits forthwith. Some 10 years later, the same scene was to witness a dreadful occurrence. The island was cut off for about 6 weeks due to bad weather. When the islanders could get into it again, they found a herdsman dead, his body putrefied and partially dismembered by his unfortunate wife who had gone insane.
I got a little bit of 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 a Yeah, the lag of heels and son of Ganeshki. Hoch we stack and I won't go to nothing to get the fat here at the car I did it. I was here, I had to work to as well he did it. Then in the car, then in my woe, we were here a snappy again, very big stick. I guess we can say, I got to do a hook to get doctor. Rivers say he could have some marketing doctor to seek. We are in Hutin, dear, this is not a new Girigumus. I guess the other hoods get begging it. Not Kiana Yanaman making it, the other ski, like I said, the Haharagi. I guess Nordy saying the stack of Dinkada. Then to let my behind just Bachra noon, and my name is the valley. Campaign it till I should get up, wheel around it, Sinelli. Madame Mahabran is concerned that they lick your open. Say, Marvin, will you go for snort?
Leaving in his Tweshkert, sailing towards the northern face of the Great Blasket, and then east by its cliffed coastline. Manana Gardin, Golin Havana Karige, and up high on the side of the cliff, Skart Fierish, where the 16th century Pyrrhus Ferteir, classical Irish poet and chieftain of his people in Cochagrina, sought refuge when pursued by the English. Cradachan Locher, for her Nagapo, Quas Nagrasan, and Lacagouch. Tomás Crehan described this place as the most odious and the least loved by him of all the place names on the Blaskets. Here it was, sometime in the early 19th century, that a whole fleet of fishing canoes was destroyed in an unexpected storm. Tomás says that 21 widows were left to lament their dead on the headland above the Lacagouch. This then was the world of the Blasket. The island's appearance was described by Sean O'Fuellan as wallowing like a whale in the darkening sea surrounded by its 12 young. It was from within this world, from the belly of the whale, that a number of writers in their own language emerged in the final decades of the island's life. This village was cradle to the writers. The island population probably never exceeded 200 people. It was from within this community that the most important of the island writers, Tomás Crehan, emerged. His writing reflects the ethos of the island during its most remote and what E.M. Foster has described as its Neolithic period. This was the home of Tomás Ronald Crehan, probably born in 1855, married in 1878, died in 1937. Only his marriage is noted in the official records. In this house, Tomás Crehan wrote on Tilana, the island man. He probably began to write it sometime in 1923. And Thelanach is an autobiography which covers the main events in Tomás's life. Tomás's story begins with his recollection of being breastfed by his mother. Eskrinleme ver vrlach mavahar. Kereblianavis sarar bunir de yulme. Esme dridren chruskin, deren oil. Chneen res sooner faga for father na kichame. Tomás's early life as described by him emerges as a heroic celebration of his youth, the happiest part of his hard life. Like the other islanders, Tomás Crehan paid a number of visits to Inishikilan. The herdsman and his family were well known for their hospitality. On one occasion, Tomás's uncle Diarmuid and himself paid a visit to the island to hunt rabbits. Tomás was more interested in one of the daughters of the house. Hugamur ga la agus ga ihaun. Bit caninig tak gach tran oonagin. Aurain ga flushikur in a hihe, gamiuk se hena clagus docha. Agus kolaga hadar an shin. Ni stadach an shan uncle gan a veheg luon a bertagin lechele, gach ihe agus gach uir. For economic reasons and family obligations, Tomás had to turn his back on the young girl from Inishikilan. Island life required a certain rigor and discipline, even in matters of the heart. On February 5th, 1878, Tomás Crihin married Marini Chaharn, sister of the island king. One song Tomás says he sang at his wedding, Cushlani Nail. Mochlan Konahi Herer, Isemalein Nachianuchtataun, Movokilin Shave Das Evrechach Me Shalaragluin, Nanosing Mishkel that is Bailach Nadien Forum Ruin, Gul Magrab on them Hagen, is the Yeglegil as a Vire Nachduch. The narrative after marriage changes in tone. Work, fishing, breadwinning for Tomás's young family, and then a litany of death. First one child egg hunting, then two more with whooping cough and measles. Tomás's son Donald died off in Travan in a tragic attempt to save Eileen Nichols, a close friend of Padraig Pierce. Tomás Crihin pithily wrote, "Well, I had to face this trouble too and go through it. Sha, beginum shasavlesh and grochas shalesh agus guathreed." Padraig O'Moyle-Owen is a grandson of Tomás Crihin. Novelist and writer, his books are largely based on the Corcoraine Gaeltacht. His mother Coet was a daughter of Tomás Crihin. She survived the Travan drowning. Padraig O'Moyle-Owen knew his grandfather Tomás as an old man. With the gradual recognition throughout Europe of the importance of the Celtic languages and their literatures, and with the revival movement in Ireland, the village was to become in time, and for a short but critical time, a virtual mecca for those seeking both a living language and its associated culture. Carl Maustrander, a Norwegian linguistic scholar, came in the summer of 1907 to study Old Irish in Dublin and thereafter to acquire the living language in the Blaskets. He stayed in the King's House and was directed to Tomás Crihin, who worked with him for 2 or 3 hours a day for 5 months. On Lochlannoch, as Maastrander was known, kept few papers from his visit, but this notebook contains some phrases collected. There was also a few other scraps which have been preserved in the University of Oslo, including what may be a sketch of an Mostr Tomás Crihin, and a sketch of island scenery with the words Sliev, Grian, Far, and Bord. There's a draft letter in Irish dated and addressed from the island. Un blaskaid, man or, kuyulai diag, megia diagas a shacht. He says in it that the islanders accepted him as one of their own. Bimon einach loha maravach dinach a feinig. Agus as machin is fair the winner tha thachig trialhra e faulam na tanga. When Marstrander returned home, he wrote to Tomás Crihin, asking him to make a collection of the names in Irish of plants, fish, and animals. Brodón, a salmon. Rohe, ray. Belach, conna. Machrail, mackerel. Tomás compiled these with the help of an Irish language teacher who gave writing and reading classes on the island. Tomás never saw Marstrander again, but he spoke with warmth of an Lachlanach until the day of his death. A little more than 2 years after Marstrander had left, another young scholar was to make his way to the Blaskets, this time an Englishman, Robin Flower, an Oxford graduate. He had joined the British Museum at the Manuscripts Department, where he became involved in cataloguing of the museum's extensive collection of manuscripts in the Irish language. Flower came to Dublin in 1910 to attend a series of classes in Old Irish being given by Marstrander. Once the contact had been made, a visit to the Blaskets was inevitable. After a boat journey across the Irish Sea and a train journey through Ireland, the train from Tralee to Dingle took Flower on the final part of his first visit. Flower describes the sea voyage. The boat runs rapidly over the waves, following the pull of the tiny patched sail. Then the lifting prow turns to the island, and in a short while the boat is running by Big Inish, and the high front of the island begins to rise over you. To the right is a long shore of sand, and Thravon, the white strand. Robin Flower was to stay at the house of Henri, and to meet his future teacher, Tomás Crihin, there, amongst the welcoming islanders. When Robin Flower came to the island for the first time in 1910, he was 29. Tomás was then 55. Robin Flower and Tomás Crihin worked together on the construction of the slipway at Colour and Oileán during Flower's first visit to the island. Very soon, Flower's hands were badly blistered working with a pickaxe. They had to be bandaged. Tomás Crihin wrote a postcard to Flower about his hands. A chara ard manamnach. Bechertam torintich the chur the huirish kvesta. Nar vran shintusha churish humon langen. Nar of the law kui ha follow. Bevalam kuntus thal wet, mashe da hele, kunus maratantu dienov. Will rien and fichoda the law force. Mishagath ard vasiga mortsa, Tomás O'Crihin. Flower married in 1911, the year following his first visit to the island. His wife, Ida Mary Streeter, was the sister of the dean of his college at Oxford and a painter. Robin Flower brought his young wife to the Blaskets in 1911 for his second visit.
My mother and father were married in 1911 in February. And that summer, he took her to his beloved island. She must have already been expecting our elder sister, who was born that December. And it was an incredibly primitive life, I suppose, compared to what she must have been used to. But she loved it. She became great friends with the with Coit, the daughter of the king, and she did all her drawing there, these beautiful drawings of the island and the houses and the general views were done there.
In the first couple of years, Flower and Tomás worked together two or three sessions a day. Flower learning Irish, writing down short anecdotes and other material. Tomás Cruachan teaching the young assistant from the British Museum as he had Marstrander. Gradually, Flower's Irish got to the stage where he began to record some of the wealth of Tomás's vast store of traditional lore. Sometimes they worked outdoors, at other times in Tomás's house, sitting in the kitchen. And so, he sitting on one side of the table, rolling a savory sprig of dillisk round and round in his mouth to lend a salt flavor to his speech, and I diligently writing on the other side, the picture of the island's past grew from day to day under our hands. At times I would stop him as an unfamiliar word or strange twist of phrase struck across my ear. And he would courteously explain it, giving parallels from the local speech or illustrating with a little tale, budded off, as it were, from the larger unit.
I remember Tomás Cruachan, O'Cruachan, who had this very characteristic face, this extraordinary jaw, because I suppose he had lost his teeth when he was, after all, a very old man. And this black hat, which he always wore, didn't he? Mm. And I doubt whether I was ever in his house, because that was where Daddy went to see him, and we were off playing games and things. We didn't actually go and invade his house, because they were always working together. They were tremendous close friends. I think he must have been one of his best friends in life. Mm. Very, very close. And they loved each other. It was a marvelous friendship. They had so much in common. And I suppose Daddy, through translating his book, knew so much about him and the kind of life he had lived and survived.
Fyddi siwas y tŵmwr gyrs eich nacht. Agus, ymsyn, nôna, hyr a dyn, nôr bych dymas o gyda hyn diach dyn isrige. Hyr se si isrige. Agus, hyr se bahan tyrt, yn tyfyg seyrs. Agus, anna'r clachtan y bai. Agus, bwrt. Agus, ych anna'r oes i'r sgiacht o dyrach na garach lil e'r sgiacht o sbwr. Ach, fer blaen iafysg o bai. Sŵn isoch.
Robin Flower was a friend to all the islanders. They versioned an Irish form of his name for him, Blohin, an endearing pet name derived from the Irish for flower. He brought his family on holidays. Two of his daughters went to the island school. Here at Clasachan Duna, Blohin spent a lot of his time on his own, working on the material of his books on the Blasket culture. This was his favorite place. It's a commanding position, a hill fort or promontory fort from prehistoric times. To the east, a view over the whole island. This was his seat over a steep cliff looking down to Carrigalochar. In 1943, Robin Flower became seriously ill. The burden of his work had tired him. His vast learning and knowledge was gradually erased from his mind. All that remained was the island and its people, his fondest memory.
Such had been the connection of my father's life with the island that when he died, my mother decided that his ashes should be scattered on this island he'd loved so much. And my sister and a great friend of ours, who grew up with us, took his ashes across. Special permission had to be granted by de Valera, but he, knowing my father's interest and love of Ireland, decided that this should be. And they went to the island, and they went right up onto the top of the dune, and there they scattered his ashes, and there he lies. And I think that's very appropriate, because nowhere was he so relaxed and so happy and so interested as on that island.
Tomás Criomhthain maintained a correspondence with Robin Flower between the years 1910 and 1926. These letters provided Tomás Criomhthain with an opportunity to develop a style in Irish which was to enable him in due course to become a writer. But it was not Robin Flower who brought the writer into being, but a schools inspector from Killarney. Brian O'Kelly first came to the island in 1917 to learn Irish, a shadowy figure about whom not a lot is known. This is the only photograph we have of him. Tomás Criomhthain writes of Brian O'Kelly's first visit to the island in 1917. Bean Cogamura Kur Brian O'Kelly Humon Vrank. Is there a threshimeger if she blien an armask? Agus is a vlaske the kashi an nalig and blien a vishe gwing. Teresh fagant of Rian, vise kur kuntish keen leichige fa kuig bliena. And she near if she sasan og a mraching ma vaha feindo, agus kunus mara churis ma heildim. Brian O'Kelly sent Tomás Criomhthain a lot of books. In relation to O'Kelly's proposal that Tomás should write his autobiography, O'Kelly sent him two books by the Russian writer Maxim Gorky. O'Kelly says that Gorky showed the way for Tomás, that a poor fisherman could write as well as a lettered person. An Tlánach was mostly written in the years 1923 and 1924. Additional material was written the 2 years following. O'Kelly sent Tomás the sheets of foolscap regularly so that Tomás could continue to write.
Is a geistach le Brian O'Kelly, a chini Tomás at hin, gur meidig rodegin is far na bialedis, na shanachas, na ili marsin. Dúrt Brian leis, kunzis a skrýva de, er a lá, a chashe, a nub, lá a chashe maur, a chas marsin do, kebwell leis, ka dúrtse, ka den chayn tu biatra, ka den ta sventis a biatra. Nu fredder le hele marsen da. Ach, is toch gebeurd van raag, gebeurd in de gede de mogere. Agus na bach eni lecht was rie wo maas te hin. Maar mech, Brian O'Kelly hacht an boger gege.
Try as he might, O'Kelly could not get a publisher for the Criomhthain autobiography. It was eventually published in 1929 by the Stationery Office. O'Kelly, a very lonely man, went to Europe and died in Split in Yugoslavia in December 1936. The facts surrounding his life are for the moment obscure. Embassy of the Socialist Federal Republic of Yugoslavia. Dear Madam, with reference to your letter of recent date, we have now received from the appropriate Yugoslav authorities the following information regarding Mr. Brian Kelly. He died at 2 p.m. on the 28th of December, 1936, in the state hospital in Split. The diagnosis was poliomyelitis. Tomás Criomhthain spent his last years with his only surviving son, Sean. He was also a writer and wrote an important book on the transitional period between the evacuation of the island and the new life on the mainland. Sean's wife, Eileen Hulevine, over a period of some 30 years, wrote a series of very informative letters on her island life to an eccentric Englishman, George Chambers. Chambers's love of the islands brought him to the Blaskets in 1931. He left an important pictorial record of the island and preserved Eilish's letters. Some of these are now published. The second of the major books from the Blaskets is that of Peg Sayers. In fact, there are two, a twin set, her autobiography, Peg, and a companion volume, Machnav Shanavna, An Old Woman's Recollections. Unlike Tomás Crehan, Peg Sayers did not write her books. Her son, Michal, a poet, writer, and primitive painter, transcribed her memoirs. The facts of Peg's life are known to many because Peg's autobiography has been used in schools for many years. Peg Sayers was born in 1873, not on the island, but in Ballyvicaire, in the parish of Dunheen. Her family were not well off. Misfortune attended their footsteps. Peg's mother, Peg Ní Vrosnachain, bore a large number of children. Many died young. Peg survived. Perhaps because she was so young and in the company of very much older people, she acquired an extraordinary repertoire of folk tales. Peg went into service in Dingle first and thereafter to a big farm east of Dingle at Knokkenvrogin. After service, Peg had intended to emigrate to America when her friend Cart Jim Ní Violáin could send her the fare. In the end, Court Jim couldn't manage the fare. The Sayers house couldn't sustain a young woman. Sean, Peg's brother, arranged a match. At 18 years of age, Peg married Padre Yogohin, Patsy Flint, and she went to live on the island. Her husband's health broke. Of her 10 children, 6 survived, and they all followed one another to America. Her poet son, Michal, returned after a short while. His health had failed him, perhaps his courage. Robin Flower knew Peg well and collected a lot of folk tales from her. Big Peg, Peg Voor, is one of the finest speakers on the island. She has so clean and finished a style of speech that you can follow all the nicest articulations of the language on her lips without any effort. She's a natural orator with so keen a sense of the turn of phrase and the lifting rhythm appropriate to the Irish that her words could be written down as they leave her lips. And they would have the effect of literature with no savor of the artificiality of composition. Professor Kenneth Jackson, formerly professor of Celtic languages and literature at Edinburgh University, came to the island in the year 1932 to learn Irish and meet Peg Sayers.
Robin Flower said I must get Peg Sayers to be my teacher and that she had the finest repertoire of folk tales in Corcaguinie. He introduced me to her and I got to know her well. She was a rather tall woman with the most beautiful eyes, violet in colour and triangular in shape. It was easy to see that she had been a beauty when she was young and in those days was called Peg Wee, blonde Peg, though she was now a grey-haired woman in her 60s. She was a strong character, very unlike the apparently meek, pious, holy woman on the frontispiece photograph in Mary Kennedy's book on her called Peg. She had a tremendous sense of humour and of fun. She was shrewd and could show a sharp tongue when she wanted to. I became devoted to her, almost fell in love with her. I used to call her a Fig Wahin, Peg Little Mother, and I think she was fond of me. I learned much of my Irish from her, and this is how I did it. I had never heard a word of spoken Irish, but I knew how to use the international phonetic alphabet, and I used to go to her every day and get her to tell me one of her great repertoire of long folk tales. As she recited, I wrote them down by ear in phonetics, though I had no idea at first what they meant. Then I read them back to her, and she corrected any mistakes and told me what it all meant in English, which she spoke fluently and correctly. In that way, I soon acquired a considerable vocabulary and grasp of grammar and syntax, and also an abiding interest in the folk tale as a literary and social phenomenon. I published later about 40 tales from this collection called Skilte on Muskerd, Stories from the Blasket. I said just now a social phenomenon, and that is what it was. The village storytellers were the cinemas and wireless of the country people of Gaelic Ireland in those days, and they used to gather in the evenings in Peg's house, old people as well as the young, to listen to her stories, which she told with great skill and expression. I remember well Peg sitting by the fire in the dim lamplight, and the room crowded with half-seen faces, grown-ups as well as children, listening to the stories they may often have heard before, but never tired of hearing.
And son we can a licky.
Joseph O'Dolla, Joe Daly of Dunchain, was a collector for the Irish Folklore Commission. He was born on the same townland as Peg. He first collected stories from Peg's sayers in the 1930s. He noted down more than 300 items of folklore from her.
Minions of the own and Vlenchin. Bene and sort prati, bene the sort prati big math and worship. I was we one corcoin a cuskin to math the more. Not a wife she who was there, all to know. I was nishin she yelled son connoisseur she shin. Not been bailed to ke, your cushy kissed at him all, sirs willing to post. Neil Meducha, now, and daughter Marum Gamet, or Wallet, Erson Van, as an alt of Mna, or Wallet, on Van Vic Postal with a hoot and son as the Coy Mach. Ushibova, a daughter Masters. August Hinchy, Saucepan Oil, it was her sheep, Dutcher of the Egg, and it was her sheep, Poder, Foxy, Lavish Dachna, Berlakas, Foxy, Mac Poder, and was a day, August her sheep, Saucepan. Agus scar gwerthachas yn cael un o colypi brach o cosacau tacht a dorys ysdach le clihon y tîs hwys, chwrs i drom lys y dyni hwys, agus y colypi cos, agus fi tamos ers, y ffiach yn tyta, agus yn son gohobon hiwlys i'n dorys y mahrysd, agus nyr fys i mehas rair gynson, chyni an ddan yn cael un y fyg post y gwts ddwt yn aldyn. Kana heim na dhuri ishe shinla mursa Tomás says, o nirif kadagam lavut to dhutsi. Ach, tamali yesin gav Tomás tim pachin shleig asir, et chui, et hewa vohar sa chaun, rvien kalin cha, ach nikshe, et tahti stach an vasan, agas fosha yin. Ach, vishi anava chuchin rodi anur marsin. Rodi mariolar, skelta mariolar, parashti, skubokar stachalis, agus marsin, agus vi nos ve leke, chun brisi stach sa skeel. Ni hos nos ef am vi ferron fa do, smikki vi agus begge do, ni er vi en rod kinti ke. Vi an chumus inte, nir i hagach en tocht brune se. Chola kursisen is eil mak feini nir hitchele heil, agus dinsin skelsan gemindom agus nara kudukus tukukus dachan tige agus e mastrahe agus baskahe marav. Luis na deori chan wusle. Agus an son wilsi gwa bas e de chele. Mastrahe. Agus kumpusi lansi rishe gan ein rian broin etan yesan. Bólat na bhfuil sí rá bas a chéad go lá sin brn tá hagin agus tá chrí. Ach bhí si anna an peidir go bé cuineóm go dó ar na hinta thugus ann trisnaise, bhíoh Ihwan be Peig in the sea at Cahir. Os corn the tinimach and Padrin the Lavaki. Agus we cross war or shillish a Padrin. The Mike and Philip, the she Agus a lunar nor Laura, Vin Cahir Marhantiga, Agus we Ajahari Kele. Mihal wish she finish Lihiana. We don't send the shedding at the egg fig, Agus Peig's Cahir. Ach, come with finish off the feral and Erklamogus, come with on Luna, there was the chorus, and on lack or loch of the east and sun, Agus could have been our little nod in the morris in board and orb. Near Omer open board, door Peig a crowing. Gusser a deation. Neven in crowing, even not as no. Ach, do she padrachans and does no marif. Agus padrachan doesn't deen we beauty. Padrachan doesn't deen not a beauty necher. Padrachan doesn't deen get a pack here. Agus don't even do she padrachan doesn't deen not a way pack here. And son did it here. Do she entangle with it. Can out of Shahatim po lahoch is a hoch tran on. Do she entangle with it. Son can she fear and look she the Christian son. Agus can she fear and look she the vein. Agus he fear and so was the chimney. Oh, because we fear and distress of flesh, and so no pinchy team. I guess it's a kick of mark around my own. It's a kick of mark around with a lack of work. I guess we should deal with my hassle, don't she? I guess didn't she smit the guy? Ach, my dear son, a dulce lamb. We are smicking in as a classic and a green and a dulce. Fig drown into it. At least, I guess. Smith the God, a necker, you call the reef, skirt the God, I am.
Peig and her son Mihal, Mike Filler, moved to this house on the mainland at Balavichara. Peg's eyesight gradually failed, and she spent her last years in Dingle Hospital, holding court with a stream of visitors and attended by her son Mike. The poet Sean O'Riordan visited Peig regularly with his brother poet, Mike Filler. Mike Filler, a dreaming seer who spent his last years alone in the damp Balavikara house, produced a fine collection of contemporary poetry. Previously, he had written a short autobiography. He also took up drawing and painting with the help of the artist Maria Simmons Gooding. Peig died in 1958, and her son in 1974. Sean Crihin, son of the islandman, Eileen Hulavan, Murisho Sulavan's sister, Mihal O'Gahin, Peig Sayer's son, and Murisho Sulavan with the melodeon. They were all writers. Murisho Sulavan's account of his life begins here at what used to be the Dingle Orphanage. Murisho Sulavan was born on the 19th of February, 1904, the youngest of five children. Murisho's mother, Coit Gahin, died when he was 1 year old. Murish spent the following 6 years at the orphanage. Knukun Charin, the hill behind the orphanage where Murish and his young companion Mikkel Dick used to play. The young O'Sullivan was to return to the island about 1911. He records his first sea journey home. We move down through a great cliff, a rough, narrow little path before us. When I came in sight of the quay, what did I see but 20 black beetles twice as big as a cow? Oh, Dad, said I, are those beetles dangerous? Then I turned my eyes towards the slip, and what did I see? But one of the big black beetles walking out towards me. My heart leapt. I caught hold of my aunt's shawl, crying, oh, the beetle! Here is the scene as Murish drew it, as one of a series of illustrations which he did for a school's edition of 20 Years A-Growing. Here was the house of Sean Leash, Murish's father. It's clear from 20 years of growing that Murish enjoyed a special relationship with his grandfather, Dado Ono Sulevain, who was a noted storyteller. The house put great wonder on me. I'd never seen the like of it before. It was small and narrow, with a felt roof. The walls outside bright with lime. A fine glowing fire sending warmth into every corner. And four Sugon chairs around the hearth. I sat down on one of them. A dog was lying in the cinders. When supper was over, my sister swept the floor and shook sand over it. In another while, the lamp was lit. Murish went to the island school. He seems to have spent a happy youth. Fishing and hunting, visits to Inish na Bro, Inish Tuishkert, and Inish Ikilan. Murish O'Sullivan is remembered by the islanders as being quite handsome and a great player of practical jokes.
Oh, that's sport, Mr. Bamish Ganish. I'm drogue to play there. If the Galaxy Gilead and the Yigmar is on the Rahul, it's Kumula Galaxy and the Russian and the name of Hai Gasaga, the Agassonson, you shall not a man, Agassonson, Tamil, you may show in the Lynchins, you cannot be sure not to see in a backlog. There's a more Lenish, Agassonson, Russia, the Galaxy, the Kingdom Gumar, and the Classy Bear. He might fix theirs. You're then rogued if the Mike fixers could die in Visham Conta. Agass Kingdom may give him the fog in the dog. Agus lixe sheer the wife could decent to know. Agus a gown tumble, he slixe sheer, as very shed, poor hog, big hoch, get on, big, half she cowan a vikico. Agus gave up my carriage. Agus, if she rag of the negative cab, go on, and not pooky by my fixers, I guess she need your shares, and the van scared the pooky by pig. Oh, dear, shell my fixers, the pooky had him first. Agus clear my dust across the tamar. Agus chach mwyd eich pwyr gogelyd. Anna'r clysio be.
In August 1923, George Thompson, a young classical scholar from Cambridge, made his way to the Blaskets to learn Irish. Murish O'Sullivan and he were to become very great friends. Indeed, he became a friend of all the O'Sullivan family. Dado Owen, the grandfather, and Eileen, Murish's sister. It was Flower who encouraged George Thompson to come to the island. The island was to have an important effect on his work on Greek literature, particularly in his Homeric studies.
In 1922, I went up to Cambridge as an undergraduate with the intention of offering Irish as my subject for the degree. But there was no provision for Celtic studies. However, persisted in my intention to study Irish, and by chance I met Arthur Whaley, the Chinese scholar who was working at the British Museum, and he said to me at once, you must go and see Robin Flower, my colleague, which I did, and so Robin Flower immediately advised me to go to the Blasket Islands. I owe all that to him. I also owe to him many talks we had when we were in the island together. It was he who helped me to understand the culture of the Blasket people, and in particular to understand that all poetry comes from the people. True poetry comes from the people. That was the great lesson which I learned from him.
Emigration was draining the island. The fishing had collapsed, and the young were going to America where a better chance awaited them. It was the beginning of the end. Murish's two sisters and one of his brothers went to America. The other brother went to work in Dingle. That left Murish. George Thompson persuaded Murish not to go to America, but to join and guard the Shikana in Dublin. Murish O'Sullivan became a recruit here at the Garda headquarters in Phoenix Park, Dublin. After training, he was posted to Connemara. Coincidentally, George Thompson was appointed a lecturer in Greek at University College Galway. Murish and he met in Galway every week. Thompson believed that Murish O'Sullivan was a good storyteller. If only he could get Murish to write. When on Tilanak by Tomás Crehan was eventually published in 1929, George Thompson persuaded Murish to take Tomás's book as an exemplar and to write the events of his own life up to the time he joined the Gardaí. Murish began the writing of his manuscript in Connemara in 1929 and continued sending it piece by piece to Thompson until it was complete in 1932.
Lunger harigalogir, tashi fat vir, pure wine, no hula, ox no chocolates. No, some playly, scale and tashtil kabla clear, and buchel ox and galeen, wound a skyle a boy leisure dryly, ox and hummer gurgoed a remog a corkic, togach fuckled out vir. No, the vishem na clear. Dinishe and scales and gominic, and Nailge, Ogus Emerle, Ogus Dortlish, Kurpu, always Grishis, Vir and Beardfree, I'll show her a comagin, Ogshe Fe, Achepel, Ogus Kachamaruige, Gabri and the Yishin, Honig Dowra Majamach, Ogus Murish. To lake Manishe, August Durche, Canina Shahidacht, Eddie, Penascree, August Forresto, Gan Bear Queen, you got a lay hoard and air, Achvea Scree Lesh, the Raid Mara Hooker and Spread Higgy, August Gagni, a hoard Fenyara, Taman the Yishin Buddhist Letter Woig. Or a garefshe a dien of the rair ma chorle. Agus gach ni egi a hor feinara. Fiu a wain an a chil a gemacht har a chloish. Si 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 ne ma gaus ne sheer an leaur. Agus as an a mach ni ar veder e stop.
Fehibli an a Foss was published in 1933 with financial support from George Thompson, and its English version was published in the same year. The book in English was to make an impact on the literary world and to be translated into other European languages. Fehibliain is essentially a celebration of youth on the island. The islanders preferred this to the other books because of its happiness. It's a young man's book of adventure. It strikes a hopeful note. Murish O'Sullivan married Coetni Cahain from Dhira Arthur, Carraro, Connemara, in 1934, having just resigned from the Garda service to devote himself fully to writing.
Ach, Peskele, Fosmud. Editehola. Good July. Native Ticha, Sakad. I was near a pin writing in him, sir, of in Lower Neha. I can no tell him. Couple here, our Fosmud Garshagari, Machas and Garda. I was going to team on the war. But some she can have. Oh, how did you find your mother when I had it? You wouldn't be dealing with a gaily chick, but I'm not. It might in the shires of the stack. It did with the shires of Rayab, Lapahagus, Pledilagus, Tocton a Cloegus, Tarakus, Jagus, a Tarakama, Nihagan Shalom. I was near my way, I was near the day. The Becky got him a fucker, my angel. Tava Eileen, the Gummidge, I was bullying, I was half on the second time I got stroke your heel. Ball much near you, and you're not nobody at all. My near she held on, and Paravias a hymn, a tarakle heel. Action ski all. After some shillish, kept my over some over gaily mach. Mehish ancient is the church, not angelum. Academy or go to seal of submission. Tama cheaply and also misses demi shule heal. I was in a shot who gave him a. But no rush a shore at doors, the church has cut out chill at Nimalish and air at the church. agus cumannam. Se chas ghlacha leis, mar dámis fí suasfa, dér fí gabe o dága sentiní. Rúd díana mé nírni, bís eidri gá chúrni. Anna gáre di chúas, vinn dér chá leis.
The initial success which attended for Hibli in a force was not enough to sustain Murish in his literary voyage. The companion volume to For Hibli in a Farce, For Hibli in Fui Vlaw, 20 Years of Blossoming, was rejected by the publishers. Murish O'Sullivan rejoined the Gordi in 1950. He drowned shortly after this while swimming at Salt Hill near Galway in June 1950. What is important about the Blasket writers is that they have left an account of life on the island written from the inside. A small but important library is their legacy. Theirs was a unique contribution to literature. It might never have been written, but for the fortunate contact which their culture made with a number of sensitive scholars from Norway and England.
These books had great acclaim, both in Ireland and widely outside once they had been translated. Now, perhaps one might wonder how two fishermen in a remote, unheard of, far western Ireland could produce such remarkable work. The answer is that O'Criffin represented an age-old way of life of great intrinsic interest, which was already passing away in his own lifetime, and that he himself had a most unusual faculty of making this life vividly present to the reader. It is a fascinating and important work by any standards. O'Sullivan was a generation younger. He followed O'Criffin in the general approach, but his picture of Blasket life is seen through the eyes of a much younger man, for whom considerable changes had already happened, and his eyes looked outwards as well as inwards. These books are both important, not only for their own fascination, but also for their value as social documents describing a vanished lifestyle which had scarcely ever been written about before.
I have also been asked sometimes, which do I consider to be the best of the Blasket books? I prefer to look at them from a different point of view. If we put them all together, side by side, we have a little library of 15 or 16 volumes, the Blasket Library. And this is something unique. There's no such collection in any other language. A collective portrait of a pre-capitalist village community made by the villagers themselves at the very moment of transition from speech to writing. Some of these books have been translated into English, and in that form they have circulated widely all over the world. Why have they attracted so much interest? What has happened to the Blasket Islands has happened, or is happening, to hundreds of other small communities of the same type in very old parts of the world. The old village communities are being dissolved and merged into larger urban units, and their cultural values destroyed. The economic level of life in the Blasket was very low, but the cultural level was high. Economic growth does not necessarily bring with it an improvement in cultural life. Blasket books with the Homeric poems. This may seem very far-fetched, but I am convinced from my own experience in the Blasket that the analogy is genuine. It's in the Blasket that I found the key to the Homeric question, so-called. What is the Homeric question? The question is, when, how, and by whom the Homeric poems, the Iliad and the Odyssey, were composed. If such a question is misconceived, we might as well ask when, how, and by whom Peig's stories were composed. They weren't composed in our sense of the term. The Homeric poems were a mass of oral tradition inherited by a highly cultivated guild of minstrels dating from very early times and transmitted by oral tradition. And this craft was so well organized that it survived into the period of writing when so that the distinctive features of oral poetry were carried over into writing. Well, this was a special combination of historical circumstances that made this possible. Similarly, in the Blasket, being so remote and inaccessible, the language and its traditions survived there exceptionally long. And for the same reason, scholars were attracted there who were interested in acquiring the language in its purest form, so that in return for learning the language from the islanders, the visiting scholars were able to convince them that theirs was an ancient civilization which had survived intact for centuries.
The literary success of the island library was not enough, however, to save the island. It was finally evacuated in November 1953. The population that survived was unable to support itself. Here at the National School at Criomhthain, looking out towards the island, the island's traditions and lore are passed on to younger generations, many of them grandchildren and great-grandchildren of the island community. The school almost died in the early 1970s, but a determined stand by the local community saved it.
Er blasket ha trågen, agus ha badet som agus tashe tog bosta.
Tomás died in 1937. His death is not officially recorded by the state. The state did, however, issue a commemorative stamp in his honor, and a headstone was unveiled over his grave in the little churchyard at Ballantampul, Criomhthain. When Tomás died, the islanders would have brought his remains down Bortín the Morav at the bottom of the village, as they had brought countless others over the years since the island was first inhabited. To him, the last words. Shkirískam in a chrín, er a landar gursi, than gemakkina a baula eginara. Agas hugas yirak ter vion an ine vim himpel a kershís. Kungamecha duerisk an arnieg, magna beg arle heidi rishon. Begin blaskeid lag an einge den drome tal luete gumselaursa. Na eine emek kinege arim.